So I want to start by saying thank you all for coming to celebrate our father, Art Boggs. Today we are following Dad's wishes, and we will share his favorite hymns and read his favorite readings from the Bible. We wish that we could have included all of our extended family and friends in the celebration, and are thankful that the Reflections Funeral Home is going to share the video broadcast tomorrow, so that please pass that message along to family and friends if they're interested in watching. So we'll start out our celebration today with Kathy and our opening prayer.
Dear Father, there is a season and a time for everything in the world. Today you have granted us a chance to celebrate the lives of our loved ones, Hart and Marnie Boggs. And we want to thank you. Even though we may be finding it hard to accept what has happened, we know that everything works out according to your plan. Give us the peace that surpasses all understanding. Give us the strength to share memories today. And let the things we share bring joy and healing into our hearts. Help us be kind and patient with one another as we experience grief in our own way.
You can see we've got lovely flowers here today, and that was definitely a theme for Mom and Dad, and so BJ's going to speak about the meaning of flowers in their lives.
I was not at all surprised to see that Dad, like Mom, had chosen the hymn in the bowl, "There is a Flower." My parents were both exceptional gardeners, and some of their favorite plants were bulb plants, tulips, daffodils, amaryllis, and gladiolus. The colorful reemergence of each of these flowers reminds us all of the seasons gone by, but also gives us promise for the future. Vermilion is truly a more beautiful and colorful place because of Dad's green thumb. He designed and built gardens and gazebos at the tour school, the nursing home, the underpass for the railway, and Mom's lookout where Highway 41 heads into the river valley. He was an avid member of the Horticultural Society, and he spent many hours beautifying both his home and community. We're going to start by singing one of their favorite hymns. It's called "In the Bulb, There is a Flower," and please join in.
In the bulb, there is a flower.
In the bulb, there is a flower. In the seed, like apple tree. In cocoons, a hidden promise. Butterflies will soon be free. In the cold and snow of winter, there's a spring that wants to be unrevealed. Until its season, something God alone can see. There's a song in every silence, seeking word and melody. There's a dawn in every darkness, bringing hope to you and me. From the past will come the future, why it holds a mystery. Unrevealed until its season, something God alone can see. In our end is our beginning, in our time infinity. In our doubt there is believing, in our life eternity. In our death a resurrection, at the last of victory, unrevealed until the season, something God alone can see.
I had the chance to spend a few really wonderful moments with Dad to share with him these hymns and these readings. And they're just really, really meaningful to him. And as I read them with him, it brought such comfort and peace to him. And so as we listened to the readings this morning, just think about what comfort that brought for Grandpa, for Dad. So Marnie is going to start us off with Psalm 23, "The Lord is our Shepherd."
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me in all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
And from John chapter 11, verses 25-26, Court David.
John 11, verse 25 and 26. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die."
And from 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3-5, Paige.
All praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is our merciful Father and a source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. When they are troubled, we will be able to give them the same comfort God has given us. For the more we suffer for Christ, the more God will shower us with his comfort through Christ.
So I'm not sure how many of you had a chance to see Grandpa, especially during this COVID period. But if you did have a chance to visit with him, this is awkward. Masking made it difficult to hear, and he so desperately wanted to reach out and hold you, hold your hand, and comfort you. Dad always found comfort in holding hands. While in the hospital, he was calmed by that simple human contact. So many family and friends have acknowledged and expressed appreciation and thanks for the many ways in which Dad used his hands, working and providing leadership at Lakeland College, creating things like his paintings and stained glass windows for the church, helping with many volunteer organizations, building his home and designing homes for others, working the earth to beautify spaces, serving others through music and ministry, and aiding others in need. Perhaps he found the secret described in Indigenous folklore that suggests hands are the antenna of the soul, and only by using them in creative and productive ways do we truly connect with others. Heart and hands. Many will grieve Dad's death because that connection has yet ended, and yet it is also the reason he will live on in our hearts. Please join me for this next hymn, which asks the Lord to take Dad's hand and lead him home.
Precious Lord, take my hand. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows so drear, precious Lord, linger me there. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call. Hold my hand, lest I fall off. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Lord, lead me home.
And I'm going to call on our brothers, Keith and Greg, who will share a little bit of Dad's life history and an interesting perspective on Dad's life from Clay Hart.
George Arthur Boggs, Art, a son, a brother, a father, an uncle, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. I'll just call him Dad. May 31st, 1929, Dad was born into the world, son of George and Anna Boggs, the third of five siblings. That same year brought the Great Depression, and times were hard for everyone. My grandma and grandpa Boggs taught the family that hard work and faith will see you through. Speaking of hard work, Dad had his first job at the age of 10. And had a number of jobs around town, and by the age of 16, he was a manager of a local McLaughlin store. In 1947, Dad went to Alberta College in Edmonton. He worked at Leggett's drugstore to help pay his way. He liked his work ethic and asked if he would accept the position in the Calgary branch. So the next year, he transferred to Mount Royal College. In 1950, Dad transferred to the University of Washington. The next summer, he had a chance to work in Alaska, where he helped build and paint the United Church. I can remember him bragging and telling us how much he liked Alaska and the fact that he had caught a 32-pound salmon. I got a 35-pounder, so mine's bigger. Even now, Dad still surprises us. I did not know that he and his brother had a successful painting and decorating company in Daysland. In fact, Dad became a journeyman painter in 1953. Later in 53, at the Daysland, he got a job at the Daysland Lumberyard, Revelstoke. Again, his work ethic impressed the management, and they promoted Dad a couple of times, eventually to a store manager at the yard in Castor. All the while, Dad had been involved in the church, teaching Sunday school, singing in the choir, and leading youth groups. It was through these youth groups that Dad met a beautiful young lady from Roseland named Margaret. They were married July 6, 1956. In 56, if you hadn't known, Dad wrote a book when he turned 80, and there's a lot of detail. In that year, 56, they asked him to move four different places before he was, two weeks before he was married. And Mom was going a bit crazy because she wasn't sure where she was actually going to live. So in 56, they promoted him to the larger branch office in Olds, Alberta. But Dad still wanted more. So he completed a correspondence course in drafting technology from a Pennsylvania college in Pennsylvania, and went on to challenge his carpentry apprenticeship exams. May 8, 1957, Susan came into the room, followed by Kathy on November 6, 1958, and me on April 7, 1960. It was in 1960 that one of the carpentry instructors at the Olds College became ill, and they asked Dad to fill in. Vermilion College took a notice and asked Dad if he'd be willing to accept the position here. So Dad and Mom packed us up, and off we went to Vermilion. Greg came shortly after, September 18, 1961. Of course, Dad became active in the community, the church, Masons, Eastern Star, Rotary, and others. He did so much more for the college than teach carpentry. He drew up plans for numerous renovations to buildings, and in 64 became an acting principal for a while. Education was still important to Dad, so he took summer programs from several different universities. In August 27, 1965, Nancy joined our family. Mom was kept busy while Dad went back to U of A to complete his B.Ed. degree in 67. BJ completed our family on December 17th of 67. With six children, the little house in the college was just too small. So in 68, Dad built, designed and built a home that we currently live in. In 1970, Dad was promoted, and he is now the head of the Continuing Education Department of Vermilion College. He was responsible for recruiting staff and starting coursework in Lloydminster, St. Paul, Wainwright, and Beggarville. Busy as he was, Dad still managed to complete his master's degree in 1972. He also formed the Vermilion Further Education Council and designed a new building for the United Church. In 75, he was yet again promoted, this time as head of the Physical Science Department of the college. Six demanding children and a high-stress job did not keep him busy enough, so he formed the Vermilion Allied Arts Council and brought teachers to the town to teach music, dance, and band. Dad was instrumental in the rapid development of the college and brought in apprenticeship programs in carpentry, electrical, welding, and mechanics. He managed to convince the college and the government of the province that a new building was required. So he drew up plans and did all the research himself, all, traveling all around North America to see what was the best and latest in trades. In 83, the new trades building was built. By 1985, BJ had won a scholarship to the Prince of Wales University in Cardiff, Wales. Dad and Mum took a sabbatical, and so they off to England to study the guild system. Upon his return of the six-month leave, he was yet again promoted to Dean of Physical Science. The staff had grown to 75 by this time, and Dad was having enough. He decided to retire in 1989. But retirement did not mean slowing down. Dad served on the Alberta Foundation Performing Arts as a member of the Alberta Trade and Certification Board and volunteered for CISO, traveling with Mum to locations in Portugal and Borneo. He was also active in the town, fundraising to build gazebos for the nursing home, planting gardens around town. In fact, Dad was so busy helping improve the town, he was named Volunteer of the Year in 1989. Dad and Mum still had the travel bug, and they took multiple trips, cruises, and went around the world. He continued to be active in the community and took up stained glass work, making several impressive panels for churches all over the province. Mum and Dad had their challenges with their health over the years, Mum finally being diagnosed with lung cancer in 2005. But she was having an anniversary that July, and she passed on December 21st that same year. Dad continued to travel a lot, taking trips with his brother to brother Vernon to Florida, several more cruises, and up to the city to look after his quickly growing flock of grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Dad met Norma Donnelly, and they were married in April of 2011. By then, the house was too big to manage, so they moved to a condo overlooking the valley. Norma passed in June 2015. Dad continued to travel, mostly visiting his grandchildren and great-grandchildren. I think it's safe to say that in the eyes of everyone who knew him, especially in the eyes of God, Dad was a good, honest, hard-working man. He did the best that ever teams involved him. He will be missed.
Well, you can certainly tell a measure of man by what DJ, Vince, and Keith have said. You can also tell from what colleagues and friends say. At a roast for Dad, I believe it was on his 25th year of college, one of his friends said the following: "I am pleased to have the opportunity to say something about the leadership and devotion of George Arthur Boggs, born in Daysland, and formerly of Castor, Olds, Lethbridge, and so on. Art Boggs has all the fine qualities of leadership necessary to be a successful bureaucrat, and the ones that have survived 25 years at college level. Many of these required attributes are visible, but may remain hidden, and it is a couple of these hidden ones I feel that must be addressed. First, number one, the gossiper. There's absolutely no way that no one knows more details, knows more juicy dirt, knows more rumors, nor knows the latest dope on every person and every subject, both in and out of the college. As someone who has absolutely no interest in that level of discussion, I can at least appreciate such a trait in someone else." Remember, this is Rose, right? Number two, the drinker. "He is a well-known patron and frequenter of the Brunswick Bar. And while I'm on that subject, I must tell you that some of his acquaintances, and I think Marnie too, believe that Rotarian art attends choir practice every Thursday evening. Some of us know or are told that Thursday just happens to be the night that a stripper comes to the local hotel. Perhaps, Marnie, this explains his singing My Sweet Gypsy Rose rather than Onward Christian Soldier upon retiring." Number three, user of rough language. "Necessary for most administrators, but Art hides this well behind his soft-spoken voice. However, we were treated to some coarse terminology during the latest heat wave in the Trade Center office. Number four, the non-caring boss. Also a trait of certain managers, but is extremely well camouflaged under Art's many acts of kindness. But don't be fooled, he can be ruthless, as evidenced by the fact that his wife's prized sewing room turned into a stained glass workshop, without even an acknowledgement of her plaintive cry. And finally, let me say that unlike some executives, Art has a keen sense of humor and a good sport. And I'm not sure about grudges, but hopefully he won't have any any about my sharing little secrets with you. However, if he does, I feel quite safe because he has 6 months to forget. So a lot of people knew Dad as he was, and that was an example of it. Dad, you've been missed.
This is an opportunity for anyone that would like to share a memory of Dad. It's just meant to be really informal, and if you want to stand where you are and share a story, that's great. Or if you want to come up here to the mic, you can do that too.
Actually from my dead Don's guessing.
His grandma
was a nurse at the college, and she worked with Dad for years, and she just loved him. And when Don was looking at what to do for Dad, he thought that buying a tree would be a good thing, and so he bought 5 trees that would be planted, so that he thought that, given the relationship between his grandma and Dad, that the trees were appropriate because they both love gardening so much. That was too bad.
Dad always liked a good adventure, and I don't know what we did, but Greg and I somehow managed to convince him to take both of us, Dave and Rick Wilson and Taylor Green, on a 7-day backpacking trip in the mountains. He would sit by this, well, it was a pretty arduous climb, about 2.5 hours up, 3 hours across a meadow, and another 3 hours down to this beautiful Klein Lake. We expected there to be multiple fish that we were going to have, and we fished our hearts out every day to no avail. It was hot, it was beautiful, and Dad would sit by the river leading out of the lake and read a book while we were out there trying to catch fish. The last day, he said, "Why don't you just fish right here? I've seen fish jumping all week." So we stayed right at the campsite. I tossed one silver lure in, I caught 5 fish in a row, all about 5 pounds. Well, 3 pounds. 5 was your limit. I gave my hook to Greg. He caught 3 or 4 in a row and then promptly lost the hook. And our fishing trip ended right there.
Hard to share, especially in this context, but we did get some tremendous memories through social media, and I wanted to share a few of those with you. Bruce Kerr, who is a cousin on my mom's side, said, "I always admired the open affection he showed his family, especially to your mom," and I think that was remarkable. Jan Schock, she said, "I love to tell the story of when we first came back to Vermilion in 1976 after we were married. I was singing in the choir that Art directed. The week before Grey Cup Sunday, I said, 'There won't be church next week, will there, Mr. Boggs? Because it's Grey Cup?' Your dad just smiled at me with that twinkle in his eye and said, 'Well, there is, but I'm guessing you won't be there.' No judgment, always love." Robin Carson, who was a fellow Mason and a good friend of BJ's and ours, married Susan Stanger, for those of you who know Susan Stanger, said, "Art was someone who I looked up to and respected very much. It is easy for me to conjure up his smile in my mind. My wish for all of you is that the pain of your dad's passing may soon become the wonderful collage of memories that are provided by a life well lived." Aunt Edie sent, "I have great affection and admiration for Art right from the beginning when he began dating Marnie. He was always thoughtful and helpful to Mom and Dad, creative, musical, patient, and an all-round wonderful person. You are very fortunate to have a father like him, but I'm sure you all know that." Judy Wawicka sent, "I spent many years working for Art. He was one of the best bosses I ever had. He let me spread my wings and always stood behind me if I made a mistake. He was so respected by students and staff alike." And Susan Stanger sent, "I remember thinking he was totally deep down nice. They both were. And then to meet you all, and the same thoughts occurred in my head. Humans always think of treasure as gold and silver or gemstones, but the real treasures are the people like your mom and dad who add so much richness to the lives of others." Does anyone else feel like they have a story to share? Right.
Well, I have to follow up Keith, because Dad must have held a grudge about losing that book. 2 years later, he took two of my best friends and myself out on the same trip. So we did the arduous trip on the way in. But this time we suggested that the lake was about half a mile. It was a good-sized lake, but ice cold. I think we went up there like July 1st. We actually went over some snow on the way down. Dad suggested, you know, there's lots of hooks. I can see them along the edge of the lake there. And he suggested that I go in and pick up all the hooks. And I could see a good chunk of hooks. So I spent the next half hour and I would go to come out. And he said, no, there's one over there. And I'd go to come out and he said, no, there's one there. And so I spent about a half an hour in ice cold water because he needed more hooks. So.
Well, thank you all for sharing and participating, and now I'll call on Susan to offer up some formal thanks and acknowledgements. I want to thank everyone for coming today and for sharing your memories of our dad, Art Boggs. Thanks to all our friends and relatives who could not be here today for your kind messages. Thanks to all the frontline workers who helped care for Dad, especially Dr. Lowe and the staff at the Vermilion Health Center, who were so compassionate and kind. Thanks to the staff and residents of the Vermilion Valley Lodge. Thanks to the congregation of the First United Church, the Vermilion Masonic Lodge, Eastern Star, and the Rotary Club. Please join us at my house after the service for treats. Ryley will now lead us in closing prayer.
God be with you in the morning, God and bless you through the day, fill you with his love and comfort, bring you strength along your way, God be with you in the sunshine, let your friendship grow so bright, and when stars and moon shine gently, God be with you through the night.
Amen. The final hymn is We Shall go out with the hope of resurrection.
We shall go out with hope of resurrection.
Hold on, BJ and Keith in the group. as we inter our mother and father. Who's got mom? The crazy get to go first. For it is here that mom and dad will return to the earth from which we all came.
Here to place flowers that they loved so well and to send a wish of remembrance to their spirits.
And now I'd like to invite any or all grandchildren to come on up to the front and help yourself to a beautiful white carnation that you can lay in the grave. Song sheet, so join in. Family, if you'd like to participate in the soil ceremony, please feel free to come and place a handful of soil into the grave.
The final song that we're going to sing is called Day Is Done. We learned it when we were at summer camp, and it's kind of the way that we ended every day. But I truly believe that this is a very fitting song for Mom and Dad's end. Day Is Done.
From the sun, from the lake, from the hills, from the sky.